came back out of here.
The one way.
Okay, folks, these people in this last car here aren't going to be able to see what I'm going to point out right now. But when I'm done talking, I'll move the cars in slowly. Everybody will get a good look at it. Right on my left here is an exposed vein of coal. It happens to be the mammoth vein, which is the largest vein of coal in the anthracite field. Now, actually, all you see right here is a little bit of your bottom coal, about 3 feet of it. The thickness that goes from that rock right there, which we call the bottom rock, all the way down in that next light bulb, which makes it a thickness of 48 feet right here. But only a couple miles west here, the same vein of coal, the mammoth, has been known to go over 200 feet in width. It will also go 40 miles east and 40 miles west. We're about in the heart of the anthracite field right here. Up it will go at that pitch 400 feet up to the surface. Down it will go at that pitch 2,000 feet underneath the town of Ashland, what will basin and come up on the next mountain north of us. Now this mine here was originally owned and operated by the Philadelphia Reading Iron and Coal Company. It operated from 1911 to 1931, at which time it was abandoned. While it was abandoned, all this timber in here rotted and collapsed. It was closed. To make it the way it is today, they had to reopen it and sand it with new timber. Now what we're in here is a tunnel. A tunnel is driven north and south. All your veins of coal run east and west. Now the idea of a tunnel is so you can mine all these separate veins of coal from one opening. Okay, now as we continue in here slowly, on the left here is the mammoth vein. Okay, folks, what we're in here is called the West 7-foot gangway. We are standing in a gangway. The 7-foot's the name of the main coal of this gangway column. Now, a gangway is a haulage way. Anything that comes into a mine must come in through a gangway. Therefore, when you open a mine, or drive it, as we call it, you drive it big enough to accommodate mules, mine cars, mine motors, what have you. Now, looking up the pitch there, 40 feet, you'll drive an airway parallel to your gangway. You drive that smaller. The name of that airway is the monkey heading. The reason for it is to circulate here in this mine. Now, I'm not going to spend very much time right here because I have a couple of drawings in a different gangway. I'll be able to better explain this to you. I just want you to remember a couple of these things. You're standing in the gangway. Right above your heads here is a top rock. To my right is the bottom rock. The vein of coal is in between the two. Up the pitch there, 40 feet, your first heading, your monkey heading. From there on up, it's called pitch mining or pillar and breast type mining. Okay, now we're going to move to the end of this gangway.
Thank you.
Okay, now remember when we started in here, I told you we're in the West 7-foot gangway. And the 7-foot was the name of the main pole that this gangway followed. So by rights, you should have 7 feet of coal right here. But if you look up there, my light's shining. You see there's only a couple inches of coal. That's why this gangway was abandoned so early. What happened, they got in here this far, the vein of coal pinched out. Now what I mean by a pinch is your bottom rock rolls up, your top rock rolls down, pinches the vein of coal out. This mountain's been known for that. But you never know. You could go into the end of that gangway there, take a couple of 6-foot cuts out of there, and it could open up to its original width of 7 feet again, and then it'd be worth mining. Now this brown muddy looking stuff behind you here in the top rock, this is sulfur iron oxide. This is caused by the seepage in this mine. What happens, all the surface water is following all these veins of coal down and washing all these minerals down with it. Okay, now let me get ahead of you here. I'm going to go from there to the wall. Okay, right here we have a drawing of this particular mine anyhow. Right out there is the entrance where we got on the cars. We were going through this tunnel. We were going due south. Now all these black lines on here represent a vein of coal. We passed them all on the way in. Wherever you've seen timber out along through there, that's where your vein of coal was. Where you didn't see timber, it was solid rock. Well, like here, you don't need it. Right here is where we're standing now on the Buck Mountain vein. That's that vein of coal right there the gangway followed. We're 1,400 feet in the side of the mountain. We're 400 feet underneath the top of it. Okay, now we're going to switch over this way. Okay, on this board, I'm going to explain how you mine coal. Let's just say we're standing in this gangway right here. 40 feet up is your first heading, your monkey heading, like I showed you back there in the 7-foot vein. Now, from that first heading on up, you have a solid block of coal we call a pillar. The only thing taken out of them pillars are your headings that circulate the air. They're 300 feet high and they're 30 feet wide. So you have a 30-foot section of solid coal we call a pillar, then you have a 30-foot section of work coal, 30-foot pillar, 30-foot section of blasted coal. Now all this blasted coal is held in place by a box and battery, we call it. The box is 24 foot wide, you have a 3-foot man weight on each side of it. Then you have a solid pillar, blasted coal, solid pillar, that's the way it works all the way to in your company workings. Now this is what we call first stage mining, and you leave a pillar of coal every 30 feet. The reason you do that is because you cannot support the mountain with timbers alone. You have to leave these pillars standing on the way in to help support the mountain. Now, second stage mining, when you're at the end, you're coming back through. You're taking them pillars out, and we call it robbing the pillars. By far, that's the most dangerous job in mining. It is also the last procedure in mining, so I'll save that for last and show you exactly what happens when you take too many of them pillars out. Now, there's two reasons you have to leave all this coal in this box until you have it driven all the way up to the upper gangway. One of the reasons is you have to force air into a mine, and you cannot circulate air in an open bottle. You have to leave all that blasted coal in that box to maintain an upcast, downcast circulation of air. The second reason is because you have two miners working each one of these coal faces up here at a time. Now, if you're up there 300 feet on a 70-degree pitch, you want to have good footing under you. Here's a side view of that miner standing in that section of blasted coal, drilling into that solid face of coal ahead of him. Your working face is no more than 6 or 8 feet away from you at any given time. Now, each morning, these two miners start up this upcast manway for work in the morning. They have to take all the material they need up there for that day. That's all your dynamite, exploders, wires, nails, 25 to 30 boards, 1-inch thick green lumber, 6 feet long. Let's say this vein of coal up there is 6 foot thick. You have to take 4 crops here, about so big, around 6 feet long. Because each day they're going up there, they're advancing 6 feet up into this solid face of coal. They're also advancing 6 feet on the upcast, downcast manway. Now once you get up in there, you're on what we call the downhill side of your shift. The drilling part is easy. You drill with air compressed jackhammers. Once you have all your holes drilled up in that solid face of coal, you'll load them holes with dynamite, string your wires down in the gangway, you'll fire that coal out from the gangway. Now all of that coal will drop down into that box they made. Once you have your coal driven all the way up to the upper gangway, you come down on what we call a battery. That's what these boards are right here. You'll open this battery up, all of this blasted coal will then come by gravity down to this chute. From this chute is where it'll be loaded into the 4-ton mine cars. That's where the mules will pick it up and take it to the outside. Now, there's two types of gases you have to be concerned about in anthracite mining. The first gas I'll tell you about is methane. It comes from mining coal. Methane's very light. It's also highly explosive with the right amount of oxygen. Now, that lead miner is way up that upcast manway for work in the morning. He has a lamp like this with him. We call this a safety light. Methane lights will hold this lamp up high as high as he can reach. If there's methane up there, it will come within the top of this lamp, come down here and roll around as a blue flame. Now, the reason this lamp doesn't ignite methane is because of the construction of it. There's two cone-shaped screens in here we call gauzes. They're precision-made. There's so many holes per square inch. Now, what them gauzes do is they dissipate the heat. They don't allow this flame to come to the outside, or else this lamp would ignite methane. Your second gas is black damp, which is simply air without oxygen. It's heavy. It lays low. So to check for that, you put this lamp down low. Again, if there's black damp down there, it will come within the top of this lamp. Come down here, either put that flame out, or that flame will start to flicker. Both of these gases are deadly. Now, does anybody have any questions on either one of these boards? So all this is perfectly clear, right? No questions?
What did they do to
different
gas?
Well, naturally, you come down to good air, which is in your gangway. And then we bring in what we call a bowl fan, or a static fan. You position that fan in such a way it forces them gases right out the top of the mound. You more or less just increase your airflow. Okay? Okay, we're going to go for another one. Okay, folks, right here we're standing now. Would be a great place to be in case anything happened on Main Haulage Way out there. This is the second way out of this mine. It's a state law, it's a federal law. It must be traveled, it must be maintained. Now right here you have a steel ladder that goes 400 feet up to the surface. Up there there's a steel gate that only opens up from the inside. That's in case any of our local children get up the top of this mountain, they don't come down in this manway. Maybe lose their footing, come falling down and hurt themselves. Now looking up there, it looks pretty rough going, believe me it is. I don't think anybody here would hesitate at all to go up there in case we had to. Now this is the way them two miners would start up to work in the morning, passing all that material I told you about from one miner to the other. Now all that material they need up there for the day would weigh anywhere from 250 to 300 pounds. Also checking for gases all the way up. Because the closer you get to the working face up there, the more apt you'll have to run into them gases. But like I said out there at them boards, once you get up in there, you're on the downhill side of your ship. The drilling part's easy. Okay, now we're going to go in here a little bit further. Okay, back there you were looking up the working face, now you're looking down. Now the original opening for this mine was right here, we're standing now in the Buck Mountain vein. They came in from the east end of the mountain, they went a quarter of a mile west in it from here. Then they went back out to the east end of the mountain, they dropped down 300 feet, came in what we call a second lift. That's what you're looking at here, that second lift being driven up to here, the first lift. Then they went out to the east end of the mountain again. Dropped down another 300 feet, came in with a third lift. So actually interconnected right here, this mine is close to 1,000 feet deep. And of course, what I mean by a lift, it's 300 feet down the slope here is a gangway, just like this one. It goes east and west. And 300 feet beneath that one's your third and final gangway. So from this gangway, you mine up to the surface. From that lower gangway, you mine up to here. It's all based on gravity to get all that loose coal to come down to your gangway. Okay, now we're going to go to the end of this. Okay, now remember out there at that board that told you first stage mining is when you leave a pillar of coal every 30 feet. Second stage mining, when you're at the end, you're coming back through. If you're taking them pillars out, we call it robbing the pillars by far. That's the most dangerous job in mining. I'll show you exactly how you go about robbing the pillar out. Now right behind here, my light shining, is one coal chute. If you follow my light 30 feet, you have another coal chute. You take the solid block of coal out from in between you. On the other side of that tip of there, my light shining, you go all the way up to the surface. Once you're up there, you start drilling long holes and rip that coal all the way down to your first heading. Then you load them holes with dynamite, string your wires down and hit a gangway. You'll fire that pillar out from here. Now once you blast the pillar out, you have to load it quick. Because sooner or later, you're taking up an amount. What will happen here is your top rock here will take weight and break. That's exactly what happened in there. They went in there a quarter mile west from here, took their workings up to the surface, started robbing the pillar back east this way. When they got back here this far, the top rock took weight and broke. That's exactly what it looks like right here on the top hill. It's holding your gangway up completely. Right here, you have a standard 4-ton mine car and a chute from which it used to be loaded. This being a tourist attraction, it's damp in here, and the work of the mine is very dry and dusty. Now, the miner being charged with loading that car with coal, but after sitting on that platform right there, my light shining, and dangling those feet down and leaving them almost full, there'd be that much dust and dirt floating around in here. Most of the time, even with the type of light I have on, you wouldn't have been able to see them a couple feet of covering that car is full. Now, of course, you're breathing in all that dust and dirt where you get the black lung. Right there, you'll see a chalkboard with today's date, my initials on it. That's one check station. There's four of them in this mine. It's a state law that requires a state-certified mine foreman asking you here every morning to check this mine for safety before anybody else can enter. Also in a working mine, you wouldn't have any electric lights like we have in here for fear of methane explosion. The only type of light you'd have is the kind of light I have on. Even a mule has this type of light to see where they're going. Now, if you'd like, I could turn out the lights right here and show you exactly how dark it is in a working mine. Is that okay with everybody here?
Yeah.
Nobody's scared of dark then, right?
Just hold my hand. He's just going to show you how dark it is when the men work.
I'll leave my light on just for a second, then I'll shut mine out. Just stand still when you go out, all right? Now you can see pretty good with that, right? That's pretty dark, wasn't it?
What?
It
didn't scare you, did it, man?
Now, does anybody have any questions?
I don't.
Let's hear it.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll take a slow walk back out there in the dark.
These other levels, like you had a little new one right here, and they don't collapse or anything?
Well, the bottom isn't open, but the tip is not, but the other one's in the water.
Oh, it's not working. What's that question?
Who has the
pad?
Boom!